On 21 September 1953, the lid came off one of the most controversial subjects of recent years. It was the MiG-15, the Red Fighter Interceptor, surrounded by an aura of fact and fiction. Now we know about the MiG, what it can do, and what it can't do. This is the story. The MiG landed at Gimpo Air Base at Seoul, Korea on Monday, September 21st. Its North Korean pilot collected $100,000, posted by the military for any pilot who could successfully deliver a MiG into our hands. At first, the plane was dismantled for shipment to the United States. But plans changed, and the MiG was taken to Okinawa instead. To prevent violating terms of the armistice, American officials offered to deliver it back to its rightful owners, but no takers came forward. The following Monday, at Kadena Air Force Base on Okinawa, the MiG was tugged out of the hangar ready to fly. Early in the morning, a plane load of Air Force specialists had arrived from Wright-Patterson Air Force Base to conduct flight tests on the MiG. Major General Albert Boyd, commander of the Wright Air Development Center, was one of the trio of pilots who would fly the MiG. Captain H.E. Tom Collins, also of WADC, and Major C.E. Chuck Yeager of the Flight Test Center completed the trio. Air intelligence people already knew what to put in the plane, standard JP-1 fuel. Oil was standard Air Force 1010, but the hydraulic fluid was a mixture of glycerin, castor oil, and water. In the cockpit, Russian language instrument labels were translated to English, and the pilots familiarized themselves with instrument placement. More than a score of technicians from Air Technical Intelligence Center and WADC checked over the craft prior to its initial flight. The aircraft's communist markings were changed, and every inch of the plane was inspected to make sure the MiG was structurally sound, and to ensure that the plane had not been booby-trapped. From the rear, the MiG's negative wing dihedral can be seen easily. Notice the large size of the rudder. Wing fences act as flow dividers to improve low-speed handling characteristics. Since the MiG's rightful owners might demand the plane back at any time, flight testing was begun immediately. The jet assist starting unit was standard Air Force equipment, the only modification being a specially made adapter plug. Metric system calibrated instruments were replaced by standard Air Force counterparts. An accelerometer was added since the MiG had no provision for one. An external free air temperature gauge was also added for test purposes. Later, a gun camera was rigged to take pictures through the gun sight during firing passes. Preliminary engine run and taxi tests were begun on the evening of the 28th in spite of rainy weather. During these, the braking system was checked. The MiG has no steerable nose wheel, but instead depends on differential braking of the main wheels to turn. Brakes are pneumatically operated from a compressed air bottle. No compressor is carried, hence the supply of braking air is extremely limited. The compressed air is also designed as an emergency system to operate the flaps and landing gear. Captain Collins climbed into the plane the following afternoon to become the first American to fly a MiG-15. On a later flight, two F-86 chase planes started down the runway at the same time. Notice how the MiG easily outdistances them, due to the MiG's low thrust loading. This factor explains the unusually good climb characteristics of the MiG. On the first flight, tests were made to determine low-altitude level flight handling characteristics at medium speeds. Functional tests were made of all systems, landing gear, controls, speed brakes, and engine, as well as handling characteristics in the landing pattern. Both in the air and on the ground, the MiG has an unusually clean appearance. Up close, it can be seen that while workmanship is good in vital skin areas, less important areas have been somewhat neglected. A coating of transparent lacquer covers the plane to reduce drag, but at the same time, MiG designers have ironically added an external antenna. The craft proved basically sound, and all systems operated properly. It handled conventionally at medium and low speeds. Approach speed on the base leg was 150 knots, final approach 120 knots, and speed at touchdown 105 knots. Landing characteristics were similar to those of the F-80. To minimize brake wear, no attempt was made to shorten landing. Much of the plane's equipment was copied from obsolescent American equipment, such as the ARN-7 radio compass receiver. The copies, however, showed good workmanship. A unique feature of the MiG-15 is its armament system. Two 23mm cannons and one 37mm cannon are positioned beneath the air intake. Both guns and ammunition are contained in a package which can be lowered by one man. This feature greatly shortens the MiG's turnaround time, since a preloaded package can be slung under a returned MiG and accurately positioned almost immediately. Fortunately, the plane was delivered to the Air Force combat loaded, so armament tests could be made. When the cannons are firing, both shell casings and ammunition links are jettisoned. Ammunition can be fired steadily for only 6 seconds, as opposed to 14 seconds with the F-86. During flight tests, several air-to-water strafing runs were made to check gun sight accuracy, as well as static firing tests into a fixed target. It is interesting to note that throughout the performance tests, data obtained compared with uncanny accuracy with information previously acquired on the MiG by Air Technical Intelligence Center. The flights made by General Boyd and Major Yeager added to the knowledge that was piling up. A series of high-altitude dives at high Mach numbers showed the MiG became difficult to control as speed increased, and at Mach 0.94, the aircraft became uncontrollable, pulling out only on reaching denser air. The top speed of the MiG was slightly less than the F-86 at all altitudes, although the MiG's rate of climb exceeds the F-86 at all altitudes. The MiG climbs to 45,000 feet in 9 minutes, while the F-86 takes 13 minutes. During dives, the F-86 is completely controllable at speeds which render the MiG control systems useless. During an altitude test, the MiG was climbed to 55,000 feet, while the F-86 could reach only 51,000 feet. In general, MiG handling characteristics at all speeds are not so good as the F-86 because of the MiG's small aileron surface and lack of elevator effectiveness. The MiG is most effective as a combat fighter at lower speeds, where its lower thrust loading allows greater maneuverability. Pilot protection on the MiG consists of an armor-plated ejection seat back of adequate thickness and the usual bulletproof glass. Fuel tanks, located in the fuselage, were not self-sealing. Oxygen and cabin temperature systems require constant pilot attention, as did most of the equipment in the plane. Pilots reported cabin temperatures as high as 42 degrees centigrade at low altitudes and below freezing temperatures at high altitudes. These extremes in working environments would seriously limit a MiG pilot's performance. At the conclusion of the tests, the tally sheet read like this. Desirable features of the MiG. 1. Ability of the MiG to operate over 50,000 feet. 2. High rate of climb. 3. Rapid acceleration from low speeds. 4. Short turning radius. 5. Short takeoff and landing distance. On the undesirable side of the score sheet are these. 1. Loss of aircraft control at high Mach numbers. 2. Loss of pilot vision due to inadequate defrosting and poor rearward visibility. 3. Poor lateral directional stability at high altitudes. 4. Slow rate of roll. 5. Equipment requires constant pilot attention. Compared with the F-86, the MiG is an inferior, though still formidable, weapon. The 13-to-1 kill ratio of F-86s over MiGs can be attributed directly to superior planes and better trained pilots. 4 days and 11 flights after the test program started, the MiG had no secrets left.